Welcome to Madison St. Baptist Church Online. We are not perfect people, but we have been rescued by a perfect Savior. Now, we exist to make disciples of Jesus. No matter where you've been or what you've done, Jesus can heal your broken places. We are excited you are joining us today.
Good morning. About lost it. I am so happy to be here. Are you happy to be here?
Yes.
I am happy to be in the house of the Lord with the people of the Lord on this morning. This is a good morning. So, we're going to try to start off right. We're going to read about Jesus. And if you don't know about the Isaiah 53 passage, This is a prophetic passage that is talking about who Jesus is as a person, what he will do because of who he is as a person. It's talking about his character. It's talking about his humility and sacrifice. So, as we always do, let's rise, if you're able, in honor of the reading of God's word. This is what the word says. It says, he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. So today, let's sing those words. If you know the song, and if not, it's pretty easy to join in when you do.
By his words we are healed.
that's what we want to remember today. The humility of Jesus, the submission of Jesus to God's plan, and the sacrifice that he has made for us on our part. And as we always do, before we head farther into the rest of our worship service, pondering that thought that Christ himself came to die in our place, God himself gave himself up for us so that we wouldn't have to bear the weight of our own sins for eternity. Let's pause. Let's look to him privately together where you are. You pray, I'll pray, and then I'll close this time off the service with prayer. God, you are so good. God, we worship you. You are our King. You are our salvation. You are our salvation. You are our Redeemer. You are the only one that we can trust in. Lord, lift our hearts. Lord, if there's anyone who is suffering here today, who is worried, who's distraught, who can't see you right this moment, Lord, open our eyes. Help us to see you for who you are. Help us to know you, Lord. Lord, give us a clear vision of the magnificence of your glory. Help us to rest in that vision. Help us to rest in the knowledge that you are the King of heaven, and that you have made promises that you will not break. You have promised that you will bring us home to you. You will do this by the blood of your Son. Lord, open our hearts to hear the word today. Help us to hear and understand, but not just to understand, but then to do. Help us to live like your people. Help us to love like your people. And Lord, guide us. Guide us as a people. Guide us as individuals. Help us to go into this world and be a light for you. Because you deserve it. You are worthy of it. We love you and praise only you. Amen. If you would remain standing as we read the last verse in that passage as a response together. If you read with me. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And you may be seated.
Well, good morning. It is an absolute honor and privilege. Matt is a lot shorter than I am, apparently. I feel like I'm reading off the tops of my shoes here, but we're going to go with it anyway. What an honor it is for me to be with you this morning. I have long admired your pastor. I think you have a great jewel in him. I think the world of Matt. And here's what I love about Matt. He doesn't compromise what the gospel is. I love that about him. He is passionate about the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I love him for it. I've enjoyed his family over the last few years, getting to know them, him and Meg, and just have a tremendous amount of respect for him. And so here's what I would say to you this morning, if you are a guest here. First of all, I've listened to the services, so I know somewhat what Matt does, and I have seen Matt many times say that, hey, if you need a Bible, there should be one in the pew in front of you. Go ahead and grab that. You can open it up with us in just a few minutes, but if you don't have a Bible, you can take it with you, and that way you'll have one and can continue to search the Scriptures. And the second thing I would say is this. If you're a guest here this morning and you haven't heard Matt preach, I would love for you to come back and hear Pastor Matt expound upon the Word of God. He does a fabulous job, and I have tremendous respect for him. So please support him. Please be there for him and be a part of what the Lord is doing here at Madison Street if you don't have a church home. Well, my name is Brent Lord. I'm the Family Ministries pastor over at the Grove in the big metropolis of Maysville, Georgia. And it's an honor to be able to get to be with you today. Matt has trusted me to continue on our series in the book of Philippians. So if you have your Bible this morning, I'd love for you to turn with us to Philippians chapter number 2. Philippians chapter number 2. As I mentioned a minute ago, I go to the Grove in Maysville. I've been at the Grove since about the year 2000. I came on staff in 2011. But when I started at the Grove, I was a part of our college ministry at the time, and it was some of the sweetest moments I ever had in ministry. A group of people to connect with, kind of a fraternity of brothers and sisters. I have relationships from that time in ministry that are still vital to my life today. As a matter of fact, I found my wife in that ministry. It was a good thing for me there. And so I love that ministry. And some of the most fond memories from that time is when we'd go do things together, which happened frequently. And I think of one particular time, we got up a group of college-age students and we headed to Duckworth, Tennessee, to the Ocoee River. And we were going on a rafting trip. Now, you can probably look at me and think, and probably one of the first things that does come to your mind is rafter, right? I'm not much of a rafter. That's not what I do. But I went along with the college ministry because that's what they were doing. And we got up there and we were a large group, so we had to split our group up into several different sections. Different rafts in order to go down the river. If you are familiar with this river, this is where they had the 1996 Olympics at, the rowing part or the kayaking part of the Olympics that year. So we're not talking about something right down the road here. We're talking about a legit river. And so here we are, first time I ever raft, and I'm getting in there, selecting the teams and who's going in what raft, and I'm sitting here praying to God that I do not get the raft guide whose name is Danger Dan. I didn't know much about rafting, but I understood I did not want to be in Danger Dan's raft. So instead, we got some other hippie-looking gentleman to be our rafting guide, and we split up, and we got into the raft, and we took off down the Ocoee River. Man, it was a ride. I'm praying the whole time, Lord, do not let me fall out of this raft because I have the buoyancy of a boulder here. I don't need to be the guy that falls out of the raft. So we're going down the river. We're navigating the rapids. We're having a blast. And I have been successful to this point. I have not fallen out of the raft. We're chatting. We're laughing. We're having a good time. We come down one rapid, and we're all leaning one way. And then we start paddling the next way and get ready for the next raft. And some of the rapids would go down straight. Some of them were spinning, going down. But we are having a blast. And we're so far, nobody has fallen out of our raft. And so we navigate the first part of the course, and we're having a great time. We're laughing, we're cutting up. Life is enjoyable. It is a ride, let me tell you. And then we get to this calm portion of the river. It's like everything just cut off, and it was just this big pool of water. It was tranquil. And we get to that portion, it comes off a section of rapids, and our rafting guide says, hey guys, let's pull over here. And we were the first raft, so I said, let's wait till the other guys catch up. So that's what we did. We pulled over. Now, what I've neglected to tell you in this story is my friend Todd was in the raft with me. And Todd had been mouthing back and forth with our rafting guide the entire time, which is normal for Todd. We were talkative people, and he had been cutting up with a rafting guide, giving him a hard time, and back and forth the whole time. So when we pulled over, they said, let's pull over and wait for the other rafts to come. And we'll all get together as a group. So when we pulled over, this is what our rafting guy said. Say, Todd, would you mind jumping over the raft for just a second and holding us here so the other rafts can catch up? Well, Todd said, sure, I'll be happy to do that. So here's what happened. Todd gets up and he hops over the boat. And we didn't see Todd anymore. Todd disappeared because what he thought was just a couple of feet of water ended up being a lot of water, and he went under. And luckily he had on a life jacket, so he bounced back up. And we have to pull him back in the boat. We all had a big laugh over it. We all giggled, and then we finished out the route. And a couple of weeks ago when Matt called me, Matt said, hey, I would love for you to come preach to our church. I said, man, I'd be honored to come preach to your church. Let's see if I can work it out, make sure I can get off that day to come. I worked it out with our pastor to be here. And so he said, I said, well, what do you want me to preach on? He said, well, I'm doing a series right now in the book of Philippians. I said, the book of Philippians, that's incredible. I love Philippians. Philippians is a powerful book, is it not? Philippians is you got such passages in there like to live as Christ and to die as gain. So I'm excited when he's saying Philippians. I'm pumped up. You get into chapter 2 and man, it's just filled of nutrients, of just beauty there about God and about our minds and our lives. And it's that passage in chapter number 2, that famous passage where it says, have this mind among yourselves which is yours in Christ Jesus. And I'm thinking, man, I'm pumped. Philippians chapter number 2, I'm ready to go, man. Matt, what's the section you want me to preach on? And Matt said, well, I want you to take verse 19 through verse number 30. And I said, you got to be kidding me. You got to be kidding me. Of all the things in the book of Philippians, you give me verse 19 through 30. Now, if you're not familiar with the book of Philippians, you're like, well, what's that mean? Well, it's like that rafting trip I was on. You get to Philippians chapter number 1, and it's full of just rapids and adventure and power and fun. And it's just amazing. There's so much theology, and there's such a power in there. And then you get to Philippians chapter number 2, same thing. It is an adventure. It is a ride. It is a powerful text of Scripture. But then you get to verse number 19, and it's that section in Paul's letter where it seems kind of tranquil. That it seems like the rapids have stopped and the adventure has become a place of pause. And it seems like it's just very steady when you look at the rest of the books because it closes out with power. But as I dug into this text this week, this is what I discovered the last couple weeks. It's a lot deeper than we initially give it credit for. There's a lot of power in this text. And so we're going to look at that here this morning. We're going to examine that here this morning. And so I'd love to take your Bible and turn with me to chapter 2, verse number 19. And here's what Paul says. He says, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who takes a genuine interest in your welfare. For everyone looks out for his own interest, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things will go with me, that I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. Verse number 25. But I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. For he longs for all of you and is distressed because you heard that he was ill. Indeed, he was ill and almost died. But God had mercy on him. And not on him only, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad, and I may have less anxiety. Welcome him in the Lord with great joy, and honor men like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ, risking his life to make up for the help you could not give. Let's pray together. Well, this morning, Father, we come to you and we submit this time to you. It is our ultimate desire this morning, God, to grow as a result of your word. Lord, this morning, your word is truth. And today we yield a knee, we bend a knee, we yield our hearts, Lord, to the receiving of that truth. And so, Father, we pray today you will be glorified and honored by what takes place in this place, and that you would be glorified and honored by what takes place in the hearts of the people here. And Father, we yearn to hear from you this morning, and we would ask you this. Lord, touch us in a way, challenge us in a way, move us in a direction, Father, so when we leave this place today, we think more like Jesus. We speak more like Jesus. And we act more like Jesus. Lord, that's our goal, is to become more like Jesus. So, Lord, take this text. May the nutrients of it, Lord, fill our being. And may they produce in us a Christ-likeness, Lord, that changes our lives and the lives of the people we encounter. And, Lord, I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Back in the early 90s, I had someone I aspired to be like. I don't know if you've ever had that, but I think it's pretty normal for us to have people that we desire to emulate or inspire to be like. And in the early 90s, maybe it's somebody that you admire a particular skill set of theirs, or maybe it's someone that you admire their persona and how they are perceived, and you just think in your mind, if I could only be like this individual. And back in the early 90s, I had someone that I inspired to be like, and Gatorade in 1992 produced a commercial about this person. It was a hit commercial for him. If I started singing the song, you could probably go with me in the song, because the song went, like Mike, if I could be like Mike. It was all about Michael Jordan, and everybody wanted to be like Michael Jordan, the best basketball player that's ever walked the face of the earth. I'm sorry if you're a LeBron fan, it's Jordan by mile. Right? I wanted to be like Jordan. When I went out and practiced basketball, and I played basketball a lot around the house, I tried to shoot and emulate Jordan's shot. When I tried to make moves and dribble, I tried to emulate how Jordan dribbled. When I tried to jump and drive down the lane, I even would stick my tongue out like Michael Jordan when I drove down the lane to try to do a layup or do some kind of move, because I wanted to be like Mike. There was only one huge problem. I was nothing like Mike. Michael Jordan had a 42-inch vertical leap. I had about a 4-inch vertical leap. Michael Jordan could play basketball for hours and not get tired. I was winded after a good game of horse. And that's where it was a big difference between me and Mike. And I was nothing like Michael, but I loved Michael, and I wanted to be like Michael. So I observed Michael. I watched Michael, and I thought in my mind, man, I want to be like Mike. I think that's pretty normal for us, and I never became like Mike. But I can tell you this, by watching him and by striving to be like him, I wanted to steal the basketball. I wanted to dribble well. I wanted to shoot well. And so I aspired to be like him to such a point that it did not make me like him, but it did ultimately make me a better player, because I had somebody to watch and somebody to aspire to be like that could show me the right way to do it. And I think that's pretty normal for us. Maybe it's not an athlete for you, but it may be a mother. It may be a mom that you've watched and you observed and you looked at and you said, man, I want to be the type of mother that she is. Or maybe it's a father, maybe it's a man that you watched and saw how much of a father he was, and maybe you said, man, he's such a good dad, his kids respect him, I want to be like him. Or maybe it's a skilled craftsman or a mechanic or someone along the way, but it's natural for us to look at people and think, man, I admire this aspect of their life, and I want to take that aspect of their life, and I want it to be true of my life as well. Because there's a necessity within us, because things are more caught than they are taught a lot of times. And we look at people and we observe them and we start emulating them and start striving to be like them. Paul understood this in 1 Corinthians chapter number 11. This is what he told the Corinthian church. He says, follow me as I follow Christ. You see, it wasn't that Paul was the destination. Christ was the destination. Christ was who we inspired to be like. But along our journey, it's necessary sometimes to look to the people in front of us, our leaders and people that are walking a Christian life that glorify God, and say, man, I really want to learn from that. I really want to apply some things from their life to my life. It's called discipleship, and we walk that path, and ultimately the goal is, yes, we want to be like Jesus. But I also learn from this person, and I can take from this person and learn what being like Jesus is all about. Well, now for almost two chapters, Paul has been writing about the Christian life. And as Matt taught last week, beautiful message, talking about really our life should be about unity working through humility. And for two chapters, that has been unpacked. And we have read verses like, to live as Christ and to die as Cain. We have read verses where Paul talks about being in prison, but even while he's in prison, it has been a blessing because the people in there have learned of Christ, and it's gotten all the way to the Imperial Guard. That God has used his most disastrous of circumstances to get the gospel out. And we've went into chapter number 2, and we've looked at chapter number 2, where it talks about the mind of Christ and what that looks like in humility and in service. And it's a beautiful, powerful text. But now, as we get to the tranquil part of the book, please understand it's very deep. Because here's what Paul is doing. He's taught us some beautiful things, but now he's unpacking it in practical examples of people they would know. And so he gives two examples here for us to look at and to learn from. The first one is an example, I would say, an example of humility. Now, let's just walk through this text a little bit. An example of humility, and he's talking about Timothy. In verse number 19, he says, "And I hope that the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive the news about you. I have no one else like him." Like him there means equal souled. "I have no one else of equal soul with me, who takes a genuine interest in your welfare." Timothy, a great example of humility. The scripture says here, Paul says of him, that Timothy was the man who took a genuine interest for their welfare. Now, it may seem sort of simplistic in thought, but think back to chapter number 1. In the early part, in chapter verse number 15 of chapter number 1, Paul wrote these words. He says, "It is true that some preach the gospel out of envy or rivalry, but others do it out of goodwill." Something had begun to happen within the church. You had people that were preaching the gospel. They were preachers, but they were in it for their own self-gain. They were in it for the notoriety of it. They were in it for the popularity of it. I mean, we still have that today, do we not? People that are more about building their empire than they are the kingdom of God. They're more about their perception than they are the perception of Christ. And here, Paul is talking about that, and he's addressing that in chapter number 1. And they had taken it a step further. The preachers of the time, some of them who were after selfish ambition and selfish promotion and were looking, wanting the crowds to follow them, these guys, they were preaching a particular message, and this is what they were saying. They were saying, "Look at Paul. Paul is in prison. And obviously Paul is doing something wrong if he has been put in prison. You shouldn't follow Paul. You shouldn't acknowledge Paul, because that's what that life will get you. He is in prison for the faith. He's not teaching a genuine gospel because Paul is obviously suffering. He's doing something wrong. He is in jail." And so they were using it to say that Paul was doing something wrong, so you should follow them because they're doing something right. People are flocking to them. People are coming after them. People want to be a part of what they're doing. They're not facing jail time. They're facing a group of people coming and following them. And Paul was challenging, saying, don't follow those people that are in it for selfish reasons. And I want to send to you Timothy, and Timothy's a young man that genuinely has your welfare at heart. Paul uses a word a couple times throughout the book of Philippians, the word sincere. In your translation, it may translate it sincere. It may also translate it genuine. Okay? He uses a couple of different words to convey this thought throughout his book, throughout the book of Philippians. Sincere. One of the words that he uses has an interesting definition. It means this: examined by the sun's light. Timothy is a young man that has been examined by the sun's light. What does that mean? Well, back in this time period, if they had a piece of art and the art was beaten down, the art became cracked or damaged, here's what they would do. They would take wax and they would fill in the cracks of the piece of art, and they would fill it in with this wax to make it look like a smooth piece of art. However, if you took that piece of art and you put it in the sunlight, what happens with wax? It begins to melt. And what it would do is it would expose the cracks into the sculpture. And it was considered to not be sincere because the cracks had been exposed. Here, when he's talking about Timothy, and he's saying he is a young man that is sincere and genuinely looking at your welfare, he's saying his humility has kept him in a place where he's not in it for self-promotion. He's not in it to try to get honor for himself. He's not desiring those things. When we look at Timothy's life, he lives that no-wax type life. When he is exposed, there aren't the cracks in him. He lives a no-wax life. And he's given it as an example of the type of life that you and I should try to live. The life of a group of people that are humbly seeking the Lord Jesus, that are striving after him. But we're a sincere group of people, and we just let the cracks be exposed because none of us have it all together. None of us are perfect. None of us are without fault or without sin. As a matter of fact, the fact that we have sin in our life does not disqualify us from Christ. It shows our very need for him. And when he examined the motivations of this young man by the name of Timothy, what he found was when the sun beat down on him, he didn't melt away. When the sun beat down on him, and we examine his motivations for doing what he's doing, for laboring in the ministry, he didn't fade away. When the heat came, he didn't back down. And he wasn't exposed as a fraud in it for selfish ambition. No, he genuinely cared about your welfare. He genuinely loved you. He genuinely wanted to be there. And when you talk about unity working through humility, what a great example for us of a young man that sincerely cared about others in the state of the church. Last week, Pastor Matt shared with you Philippians chapter number 2, verse 3 and 4, that says, "Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also the interest of others." So when we look at this example of humility, we find a young man that had been tested. Matter of fact, in verse number 22, it says, "But you know that Timothy has proved himself." That word "proved himself," that phrase means tested by fire. Here's how you know the true from the false. Here's how you know those that live a sincere life from those that are in it for their own ambition. Is when the sun beats down and the heat comes and they have to walk through the fire, do they continue on? Do they persevere? Do they carry on the flag of the faith when everything is crashing down on them? When maybe millions were following him, but when nobody is following him, do they live the sincere life tested by fire that they go through some things, but not only they go through some things, they come out of some things praising God in the middle of it all? That's the type of man that Timothy was. Paul had worked with Timothy, he had walked with Timothy, he had been with Timothy, and he had examined Timothy's life to such an extent that he saw Timothy walk through the hard times of ministry, the difficult moments of ministry, the irritations of ministry, and the attacks of ministry. And Timothy kept on keeping on because there was something inside him that burned him to do so. And he sincerely had a passion for other people when it would have probably been easier for Timothy many times to give up, walk back, and go back to a normal, regular, calm, tranquil life. But there was something in him that said, I have to not only look at my interest, I've got to look at the interest of others. And propelled him to go forward. Let's look back at our text here. Are you guys with me? Are y'all awake? Okay. I did tell somebody earlier I was going to preach for about 2 hours. And they said, hey, can we take a nap in the middle? I said, yes, I will join you in that. And so if we need to do that, we will, okay? And I'm not really going to preach for 2 hours because my mom's here and she won't let me do that. So let's look back at verse number 20. It says, I have no one else like him, meaning Timothy, who takes a genuine interest in your welfare. Now watch this. For everyone looks out for his own interest, not those of Jesus Christ. So Timothy's humility took him in a direction where he was looking after the welfare of the others, the other people within the church. But don't miss that last part. Not only that, but elevated in his life were the interests of Jesus Christ, not his own interests. Now, when I said this is a lot deeper than we initially give it credit for, here's that part where it's a lot deeper than we initially give it credit for. Because he elevated the cause of Christ and the interest of Christ above everything else. Don't we have a hard time with that? John Phillips said this. John Phillips said, the curse of the local church today is lack of commitment. So few are willing to make an out-and-out commitment to a task. The same faithful do nearly all the work. I can't tell you how many times over the last few years you'll be in a conversation with someone, they say, I would serve, but I'm just too busy. My kids have this activity, or I got this going on, or work's just crazy right now. I would serve. I would be a part. I would do it, but I'm just simply too busy. I have what's being communicated there is I have too much going on in my life to dedicate in my life and elevate the interest of Jesus Christ in my life. And here Timothy is saying, listen, I have ambition. Sure, everybody has ambitions, but when Timothy's life was examined, Timothy didn't give all the excuses we like to give. Timothy said, I want to elevate in my life the interest of Jesus Christ, because to live is Christ, and to die is gain. The most important thing in my life is not my own ambitions, not me making my own kingdom, not me doing my own thing, not me having a comfortable home, not me doing life the way I want to do life, not my kingdom. The most important thing in my life is fulfilling the very interest of Jesus Christ, because that's why I exist. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. In Luke chapter number 9, I want you to listen to these words of Jesus. He says, as they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, follow me. And he said, and he replied, the Lord, first let me go bury my father. And he's saying, Lord, it's basically translated to my father's getting older. Let me make sure I take care of that first, and then I will follow you. And listen to Jesus' reply to him. He said, let the dead bury their dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. I still another said, I follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. When we read a text like that, that didn't jive with the hippie version of Jesus that we create, does it? Because what Jesus was saying is, if you want to follow me, there's a commitment, there is a cost. It will cost you things to follow me. I wrote these words in my notes. In an effort to get people in the door, we have created a perversion of discipleship that is void of cost. One that caters to the convenience and promotes immaturity among those that claim to be of the faith. Believers that are not only living in this world, but for this world. They dare not have to sacrifice their lives for the mission of Jesus, and as a result, only give of their excess, and of their excess only. They will serve if they have excess time. They will give if they have excess resources. When we give the leftovers of our lives for the cause of Christ, we reveal truly what is the driving force in our lives. That is our kingdom and not his. And Paul sent Timothy because Timothy was an example of a young man that had been tested by fire, shown sincere to be with no wax, and living a life dedicated that had elevated the mission of Jesus Christ over his own self-interest, and I would add, as a detriment to his own self-interest at times. What an example of humility. It goes on to say that Timothy has proved himself because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. Now look at the title Paul gave Timothy. He said, as a son in the gospel. You see, Timothy was a young man that Paul had personally poured into. So not only was he an example of humility, he was an example of humble discipleship as well. He had said, Timothy, walk with me and I will pour into you. And Timothy flourished as a minister as a result of Paul's investment. But Paul looked at him like a son, one that I am pouring into, one I'm investing in. Matter of fact, in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 2, this is what the Paul wrote to Timothy. He said, Timothy, the things that you've heard among many witnesses, teach those things of faithful men who will teach others also. He says, Timothy, the things that you've heard from me, the things I've taught to you, take those things and find some faithful men and pour them into faithful men who may eventually go on and teach other people also. That is the priority of the gospel in our lives, that we go out and make disciples, that go out and make disciples, and that is the elevated purpose of why we are here. And in humility, Timothy, as a great example, brings that forth. And so we see this great example of humility in Timothy. But as we go on, we get to verse number 25. And we get to this secondary character, a guy by the name of Epaphroditus. We don't know a lot about Epaphroditus in the scriptures, but we do see here in this text that Epaphroditus was a great example of unity. So how can I say that? Well, let's look back at the text for just a moment. It says in verse number 25, but I think it necessary to send back to you this representative, this guy that had been sent to Paul, named Epaphroditus. My what? Brother. Now, Timothy was what? A son. Timothy was an example of discipleship, an example of someone that he had poured into, this humble guy that has sacrificed his entire life for the purposes of Christ. Timothy is a beautiful example of that, what Paul has been teaching. But here we see an example of someone that shared a unity with Paul. Paul calls him a brother in the faith. You call someone a brother if they're of the same household you are. If there's a connection to you by family, that meant they were of the same family. Now, they might have not have been by blood, but they're by his blood, that they were united together in the same family in unity. And here he mentions Epaphroditus as his brother, but he goes on and he specifies some things. And he says, yes, he's my brother, but he doesn't stop there. He calls him a fellow worker. You see the unity in that. Fellow worker. We're working together for a cause, and the cause being Jesus Christ. I think it's a powerful thought conveyed there. Fellow worker. Fellow meaning that it's somebody that is beside me in the labors of ministry. Someone that is like-souled with me going forth for the cause of Jesus Christ. Someone that is unified with me in that aspect. But he calls him a fellow worker. When I read that, I automatically thought of something that the Lord Jesus said in Matthew chapter number 9, when the Lord Jesus looks out and he says, the harvest is white unto, the fields are white unto harvest, but the laborers are few. The laborers are few. You know, I'm confident of this, that when it comes to the gospel, many of us in here would say, yes, I buy into that. I believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. I believe that Jesus Christ died for my sins. I believe it should have been me on that cross, but instead Christ took my place. That is the beauty of the gospel. It is Christ in our place. He took the penalty for our sin, and he died on a cross, and the burden of our sin was laid upon him. And 3 days later, he was resurrected in victory, and Christ overcame our sins for us. What a beautiful, beautiful picture of love and of grace. And we would celebrate that today. We read about it just a few moments ago. Excited about what the gospel ultimately is. And I think we like the idea today of seeing many, many people flock to the gospel. I know that's a burden in my heart, and I would imagine in your heart as well, you share that enthusiasm to see our churches packed with people wanting to know more about Jesus, wanting to know about the gospel, to see our streets where people are praying on our streets, to see our places of work, revival break out in those rooms, and people coming to know Christ as we labor beside them and whatever material we're making or whatever product we're producing. And we see this. I think that's a yearning. It should be a yearning in every Christian's heart. And I would imagine today, if I said, let me see a show of hands, how many people want to see the gospel impact our area? I would imagine Madison Street Baptist Church, you would join the people of the Grove and said, that's us. We want to see that. If I would say, how many of you want to see a revival in our nation where Jesus is made prominent and he's respected above all, and people in the White House bow down to him, people in the Congress bow down to him, people in our local government bow down to him, and I think we would all say, yes, yes, we want more of that. We need more of that. But how many of us are willing to labor for it? How many of us are willing to work for it? How many of us are willing to lay our kingdoms aside for the kingdom of Christ? You see, Paul had found a young man, or found a fellow worker, a brother in Christ that said, I am a fellow worker. You see, the fields are still white under harvest. Unfortunately, we live in a generation that doesn't think they should have to lift a finger to go out into the fields. The text is deeper than we give it credit. Wait a minute, I thought the gospel was all about grace. Yeah, the gospel is all about grace. I thought the gospel was all about mercy. Yes, the gospel is all about mercy. But please never confuse effort for earning. You see, you cannot earn salvation. The Bible is clear about that in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. You do not earn salvation. Your works will never produce salvation. You can't earn it from that perspective. But you can labor in service of it. And there's a big difference between effort and earning. You can't earn salvation. That is by grace through faith, faith alone. But if you have salvation, the fields are wide unto harvest. Who let it not be said of us that we're a group of people that won't labor for the master that we claim to serve. Epaphroditus was a fellow servant. Paul goes on, he calls him a fellow soldier. He's in a fight. Paul looks over and says, who's going to fight with me? And here's a guy by the name of Epaphroditus. And Epaphroditus says, brother, I will fight with you. Not only will I work for the sake of the gospel, not only will I sacrifice for the sake of the gospel, but I will labor with you and I will fight with you. You see, everybody that's ever been in the military would say they had a mission to accomplish. And the mission that we have to accomplish given to us in Matthew 28:19 was this. We are to go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe whatsoever I have commanded you, Jesus says. And he gives us that great promise at the end that he will be with us always, even to the end of the world. The mission was clear. The labor is before us. Are you willing to jump on the battlefield and be a part? And what a great example here of Epaphroditus. But not only was he unified with his brother in ministry in Paul, but he was unified with the church at Philippi. Last week, or a couple weeks ago, I think it was last week actually, that Matt brought up about to live in Christ and who to die is gain. And what that means, and he talked about it meaning that we have unity working through humility. And as a part of that, here's what happened with Epaphroditus. He was a representation of this church at Philippi. He was a humble servant, unified with that church, and unified with them in such an extent that in verse number 25 it says, "Who is your messenger whom you sent to take care of my needs?" So Epaphroditus was, that word messenger actually alludes to him having a position within that local church, that he went out to take a love gift. You can read about it in chapter number 4. Epaphroditus was elected by that church to take a love gift to Paul, who was facing imprisonment right now, to give him money and a gift. And he goes up to Paul and he's laboring, he gets to Paul and he's investing in Paul and he's blessing Paul with his financial aid and these gifts, and he's ministering to Paul. He's a fellow encourager to Paul. Don't we need some encouragers today? And he's that guy for Paul. He's encouraging him. And in the middle of that, the Bible says that he gets sick. And when we're talking about sick, we're talking about bad sick. Now, we can understand that today. We're in the middle of a pandemic. Seems to kind of fit where we're at. And so he went to where Paul was. He's ministering to him there. In the middle of being there and ministering to him there, representing the church that he was a part of, he gets very sick. And the Bible says that he was at the point of death. Now, God did something miraculous here at some point and brought him from that. We don't see. It's amazing because he goes to Paul, and at points and times in the book of Acts, Paul was used as a great vehicle of healing. But here we don't see that with Paul. And now he gets sick. And the Bible says this, that in the middle of his sickness, he gets concerned. And what he's concerned with is not his sickness. And I don't know if you caught that when we read it. It's pretty interesting. He's not overly concerned with his own sickness. Now, here's a guy that could die. Here's a guy heading in the wrong direction in health. But what is primary in his mind is not his own health. It says, no, he's greatly distressed. What that word greatly distressed means is he's depressed. Okay? But he's depressed not out of self-pity. He's depressed because in his mind, he's wondering, am I stressing out the church that I'm representing? Are they worried about me? And it bothered him more in his mind that the church could be distracted, that he might be so sick, more so than his own sickness was bothering him. Why? Because he truly believed to live is Christ and to die is gain. It was a win-win on every front for him. And yet he's greatly distressed because he's wondering what's happening back at the church. Are they worried? Because I can tell you this, the last thing he would have wanted was for his sickness to cause one moment of distraction, one moment of hesitation, one moment of a thought going in another direction outside of the purpose and cause of Christ. You see, he was unified with Paul. He was unified with the church at Philippi. He loved the very bride of Christ. But he was unified with Christ, who would give up his life in a heartbeat for the mission of the kingdom of God. And Epaphroditus almost had to literally do that. And God heals him. He touches him. And so here's what Paul does. Paul says, you get back to that people. You get back to them. Go minister to them. God's not done with you. You keep the cause of Christ before you. And you go back and you minister to that group of people. And Epaphroditus launches out to go do just that very thing. Why? Because of the unity you felt with Paul, with the church as a whole, and with Christ himself. And he kept the mission of Christ before him in all he did. Thinking back to last week, verse number 4, each of you should not look not only to his own interest, but to the interest of others. And we have these two figures that we can look at and we can admire these qualities in their life. Timothy, for his great humility and sacrificial love that propelled him for the mission of Christ, and the unity found in Epaphroditus. And we truly see what Pastor Matt was trying to teach last week when he said Philippians is a book all about unity working through humility. And here are these two figures that ultimately are a perfect example of both, along with Paul and Jesus himself, of a group of people living out unity working through humility. They were dedicated to the mission, sometimes at their own self-detriment. Why? Because the cross of Christ was worth it. It was worth it. And the question is, what would be said of you? What would be said of you? Are you the person that says, let me get my life right first? Let me live my kingdom first. Let me enjoy these years of my life now. And then I'll follow you, Lord. And then I will serve you, Lord. Are you willing to be humble enough to say, God, use me now. Use me now for your kingdom. Don't use my excess. Let me use my sacrifice to build your kingdom. Are you willing that to be said of you? Some questions to reflect upon. Question number 1, am I driven by selfish ambition or by the interest of Jesus Christ? What do your conversations reveal? What does your bank account reveal? What does your time reveal? And are there areas where you can make a difference for the kingdom of God that you would say, I currently don't because of simple lack of commitment? Maybe there's a place in this local church where you could serve. Maybe it's a place in the nursery. You say, well, I can't do that. Listen, you can do it. Maybe you're not musically talented, but maybe there's something you can do. Maybe you can work a sound booth. Maybe you can go serve and lead a life group. Or maybe you can go and say, I can't feel like I can lead a life group now, but I want to go be a part of one so that I can learn that one day I might be able to do that in service of the Lord. Because primary in my life, I want to see a unity with Christ, a unity with His church, working out in humility for the cause and the purpose of serving the kingdom of God, because the reason why we exist is to make disciples. And you may wonder why I feel so off purpose in my life. Here's what I can tell you. If you are a Christian and you're in this room today, you will never feel on purpose in your life if you're not in a position where you're making disciples. Why? Because that's why you're here. And Timothy and Epaphroditus gave it all in order to say, to live is Christ. And there is joy in that. There is fellowship in that. There is intimacy in that. There is beauty in that. Why? Because there's nothing better than Christ. There's nothing better than Him. And so as we close out today, in this moment, evaluate yourself. As I'm going to evaluate myself. This is not a me and you thing. This is a we thing. And Lord, what would you have us do with this truth? Maybe it's saying, you know what? I've given excuses long enough, and I'm going to find a place to serve in the local church. Let today be that day. And I guarantee you, Matt McKinney, who did not put me up to that, by the way, He's not going to turn you down. A Brad Puckett's not going to turn you down. Why? Because we're all the body of Christ, and each one of us is important. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you so much for the great examples you gave us. We thank you so much, Lord, for that beautiful example of a son in Christ, Lord, in Timothy. A humble servant that your word says didn't labor for selfish ambition. But nah, he elevated the cause of Jesus Christ in his life. Lord, I thank you for the beautiful example of unity, a fellow brother, a fellow laborer, a fellow soldier in the faith in Epaphroditus. Today, may we pause and may we celebrate the fact that as we are in this room worshiping together, Lord, that we get to do it together. That we look around and we see fellow brothers and we see fellow sisters of the faith united through the cause of Jesus Christ and His kingdom. And so, Lord, today as we churn this, as we churn these truths, Lord, may we apply them to our lives in such a way, Lord, that we think more like Jesus, that we speak more like Jesus, that we act more like Him, because, Lord, in every community there needs to be a light of people that are willing to labor for the cause of Christ, that are willing to fight for the cause of Christ, that are willing to set aside their own agendas and their own lives for the cause of Christ, for the Grove, for Madison Street Baptist Church, for the churches down the road, for the people of God down the road. Lord, may it be said of us that, yeah, the fields are wide unto harvest, but there's some laborers going out to the fields. Lord, as Paul closes out this section, he talks about Epaphroditus and how when he gets back to the church at Philippi that they should honor him because he almost gave up his life for the gospel. Lord, may, as I pray right now, Lord, I would ask you to bring to our mind's eye people in our lives, Lord, that made a difference for eternity in our souls. Maybe it was a Sunday school teacher, a teacher, a coach. Maybe it was a pastor. Maybe it was someone leading music. Maybe it was someone working in the nursery. Maybe it was someone that you encountered at work. Lord, those people should not be worshipped, but Lord, the people that sacrifice for the investment of the kingdom of God, may we honor them. And so Lord, as whatever that person is, whoever that person is, may at some point this week, Lord, whether it's through a card, a note, a text, help us to be mindful of honoring them by just saying thank you for your service for the cause of Christ. You've made a difference in my life. So God, may we be difference makers for the kingdom of God. May we be encouragers in the kingdom of God. And Lord, may Jesus Christ be our priority that all priorities come out of. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for that. Let's respond. If you can't rise, do this song. This is one of our songs. We know this song. And if you don't know this song, get again. Join the wing.
My worth is not in what I am. I am. thank you for Pastor Brent and the message that he delivered to us. Let us take it with us and use it today, dear Lord. And it's time for us to just give back a small portion of what you have blessed us with. We ask that you take it and multiply it, that your will be done on this earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And as the ushers pass the plates, first we want to say welcome. Welcome to everyone visiting. Welcome to everyone in attendance today. Special welcome before we get to Brent. Welcome to Sarah. We are so glad that Sarah was able to come and worship with us today. And she wasn't holed up in the children's ministry. What an amazing surprise and delight to look out and see you there. That was great. Brent, I realize I did not welcome you before you walked up. Everyone, I want to welcome Brent Lord, Pastor Brent Lord, and thank you so much for preaching today. What an amazing word. I really appreciate it. And Tim, thank you for joining us. Really appreciate your presence here with you, brother. I love that. The idea of bringing a fellow worker along, 2 Timothy 2:2, do these things, teach those who are with you, bring them along, show discipleship to the one who's next to you. We all have somebody who's next to us somewhere. It's an amazing display of exactly what you were talking about. So, we read this together. So, Madison Street Baptist Church exists to make disciples by teaching and obeying God's word for the praise and worship of King Jesus. And we believe a disciple is one who follows Jesus with ever-maturing love that results in heartfelt obedience. We only have one announcement, as far as I know, today. And that is that the overview of the Bible was such a big hit that we're going to do it again. If you missed out the first time, connect with somebody who was there because it was amazing. This next time is going to be on October 10th from 2 to 6 p.m. And it's literally Pastor Matt is going to tell the story of the Bible. He says that he likes to study that passage before he starts. He studies his passage the morning of before he gets up and preaches. And I'm not sure how he's going to do that if the text is the entire Bible. But that's what he does. So if you haven't been to that, if you know somebody who was, talk to them. Because the story of the Bible is one huge story about Jesus and what he has done, who he is, and what he has accomplished for us, and what we get to enjoy in him. So it helps all the other pieces of the Bible make sense. As we finish up our time today, we're going to go straight to the doxology. You probably know this one, but just in case you don't, the words are on the screen. So here we go.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Thanks for joining us online today. If you would like more information, visit us at madisonst.org. If you have any questions or prayer concerns, you can always email us. We want Commerce to know we are here for you. Have a great day, and we'll see you next week.